I'm Dr. Rightmire. So I'm going to talk about knee injuries, focusing mostly on the more common injuries that we see in the office every day, which, similar to the hip talk, it mostly focuses on our bursitis and tendonitis, and which are largely non-operative. So, but the most common things you would probably see in a primary care setting or urgent care setting. So patellofemoral syndrome is a fancy name for kneecap pain, anterior knee pain, chondromalacia patella. It's got a bunch of different terms that describe it. Patella or quadriceps tendonitis, also very common. Less common are meniscal tears, which can be either stable or unstable, which we'll get into, and then ligament injuries. Four main ligaments in the knee. You have the MCL, the LCL, the collateral ligaments on either side, which imagine the knee's like a hinge joint. Those are the hinges. And then the ACL and the PCL, which are the two cruciate ligaments in the middle of your knee that actually cross over, and the anterior cruciate stabilizes the knee this way as well as this way, and the PCL in reverse. And then osteochondral defects or cartilage lesions within the knee. And I'll touch upon arthritis, but that's not going to be the focus of this talk. So, so patellofemoral syndrome, again, pain around the kneecap due to a muscle imbalance where the quad gets weak relative to the hamstrings and the IT band, which run down the opposite side of the knee. So in particular, the VMO is the stabilizer of the kneecap. The vastus medialis, one of the four quadriceps muscles, keeps that kneecap in centered in the knee, keeps the hamstrings and the IT band in check. If that muscle is weak, which you can see on exam, people who come in with patellofemoral pain, you take one look at their thighs while they're keep holding their legs out straight, and you can see an obvious difference in the knee that has pain. And it can happen due to an injury where they had a minor sprain or even an injury that they don't recall that leads them to favor their knee. They limp around a little bit for a few weeks, and you can see that atrophy of that muscle develop very rapidly. And if you get an x-ray, you can actually see it oftentimes where the kneecap, instead of being centered there in the trochlea or the groove, it's drifting off to the side. And that can confirm the diagnosis. Very common in all age groups, but in particular young female athletes, because they have a little bit more of what we call a Q angle, where the hips tend to be a little wider, their knees tend to come in a little bit, so that kneecap has more of an angle to navigate than in someone with narrow hips and straight knees. So again, the muscle atrophy, hamstring tightness, presents as swelling and pain around the kneecap, particularly when you're loading your kneecap joint, going up and down stairs, getting up out of a seated position, and can present mostly pain around the kneecap itself, but can present as pain behind the knee or diffuse sort of generalized pain. They just say, I don't know where it is, it's somewhere in my knee, as opposed to medially or laterally. So physical therapy to treat the weakness in the, correct the muscle imbalance by strengthening up that VMO and stretching out the hamstrings is 90% effective. It is an inflammatory condition. The pain comes from inflammation. So oral anti-inflammatories typically relieve the pain enough to allow patients to do their therapy exercises more effectively. Cortisone injections, not very frequent for that condition. I don't like to inject in joints that are otherwise healthy, meaning no arthritis. I mean, if you're doing injections in bone-on-bone arthritis and they're having pain relief for months at a time and they're avoiding a knee replacement, that's perfectly reasonable. But there are complications from injections leading to potential tissue degeneration or even cartilage damage over time. So it does provide some relief. And if it's just a severe case where they're in such pain that they can't do their exercises properly, then that would be an indication to do it. Cortisone injections alone for the condition provide short-term relief because you're not correcting the underlying problem, which is the muscle imbalance. Symptoms return pretty quickly within a few months, and so it always needs to be combined with the physical therapy exercises. Surgical options are pretty rare. Again, 85-90% of patients get better with conservative management, and you'd want to exhaust that option before resorting to any surgical options. And there's multiple surgeries for patellofemoral pain, which is never a good sign. It means that none of them work very as well as we'd like, so we're always coming up with additional, trying new options, trying different things. So soft tissue repair, if there is instability of the kneecap, where it's not just a muscle imbalance, but an actual structural defect. The MPFL is the medial patellofemoral ligament, which can tear when you dislocate your kneecap. It runs from the kneecap over to the side of the femur and can be repaired and can fix an instability problem. And microfracture if there's cartilage damage. And then more effective are the realignment procedures, the Fulkerson osteotomies, which means cutting the attachment where the patella tendon attaches to the tibia and moving it over. So instead of the patella making an angle, as it tracks across the end of the femur, you're straightening out that angle, which works great, but is a pretty major procedure with a lot of disability, long recovery, 3 months, so not something that most patients want to go through. And then we're doing more patellofemoral replacements for patellofemoral arthritis with the new unicompartmental knee systems, the Makoplasties, and whatnot, so, but not very common. So moving on to patella tendonitis, this is one of the most common conditions we see in the office, and I'm sure in the community as well. And it's a tendonitis, so inflammation of the tendon or tendinosis in some cases where it's not actual inflammation, but just degeneration of the tendon where it's not healing properly. As opposed to the patellofemoral syndrome, which happens in less active patients or patients who are sort of weekend warriors and don't spend the time and effort to tone their muscles, this is more common in the more active athlete, the high school or college athlete in particular, and it's also called jumper's knee, or and it is due to a lot of overuse, which you would see in volleyball, basketball, jumping, soccer, fencing, lunging, telemark skiing, that sort of thing. So again, you see it more often in the higher level athlete than the recreational athlete. And we believe it's due to just damage that occurs to the tendon, and a lot of tendons in the body are prone to this. We see this in the distal biceps, we see it in the Achilles tendon, the tennis elbows, the medial and lateral epicondylitis of the elbow, tennis elbow, golfer's elbow. Increased demand to the tendon probably causes micro damage over time. You tear a few of the fibers here and there, and if it repairs, then you're fine. But if you get into this negative feedback loop where the tendon has a poor blood supply and isn't healing properly, it leads to cell death, further reduction in the collagen fibers, predisposition to further injury because the injury because the tendon's already injured, and you get into this cycle. So a lot of the times it's not an inflammatory process, it's just this degeneration of the tendon over time. So sometimes people don't respond to the anti-inflammatories or the cortisone injections as you would expect. There's intrinsic factors, age, less frequent in young kids. They tend to get, when the growth plates are open, that's kind of the weak link in the chain. So there you'll see growth plate inflammation or apophysites where Osgood Slaughter's, which is where the patella tendon attaches to the growth plate of the tibial tubercle, becomes inflamed and even starts to separate a little bit. And the syndiglarsen is at the other end of the tendon, where at the base of the patella you see inflammation at that growth plate. And again, hamstring tightness, quad weakness are the cardinal signs. And then there are the extrinsic training types, so that we always talk about open chain versus closed chain. Open chain is like a leg extension where you're putting the bar on your ankle and extending it. That is a bad exercise all around, I think, but in particular people who are prone to patellofemoral symptoms, there are other ways to strengthen the quad through squats or closed chain where your foot is on the ground or on a platform or a bike pedal or an elliptical. It's not coming up and coming down again. Playing surface harder surfaces are associated with increased risk, and then the frequency of training again for patella tendonitis, the more overuse involved, the higher the risk of developing the problem. So you can see quadriceps atrophy mimicking patellofemoral pain or turning into patellofemoral pain just because it's painful and you start to favor it. And then pain of the patella tendon with resisted knee extension, and sometimes not a lot of redness or inflammation or swelling because it's this degenerative process as opposed to an inflammatory process. You can sometimes confuse it with a fat pad irritation, which is the structure immediately behind the patella tendon below the kneecap, and sometimes can inject a little bit of lidocaine or something into that fat pad to distinguish whether that's the fat pad or the patella tendon that's producing the pain. Tenderness and swelling, sometimes there is some swelling. X-rays, MRIs rarely needed because it's mostly a clinical diagnosis. Treatments are relative rest, switching up activities to ones that don't produce the pain, moving from open chain to closed chain exercises, reduction in jumping and running, resting, and anti-inflammatories. And then the rehab is very similar to the patellofemoral rehab, strengthening up the quad, eliminating any atrophy, stretching out the hamstrings and the IT band, and then progression to functional activities. So certain indications, certain conditions are corticosteroid injections are contraindicated, and this is one of them because it can lead to patella tendon rupture. It's just like the Achilles tendon or the distal biceps or these tendons that have poor blood supplies. We never inject them because if you end up with a patella tendon rupture, that's a pretty devastating injury. And that's normal patella tendon here. This is the torn patella tendon. So I'm going to go move on to this next. So causes of patella ruptures, patella tendon ruptures, there's pre-existing patella tendonitis. Which causes damage to the tendon, which can weaken it and allow it to potentially tear during a violent contraction. The quad flexes and too forcefully, and the tendon just gives way. Steroid use, anabolic, builds muscle, doesn't increase the tendon size, so you end up with big muscles and the same size tendon that you were born with, so you can overload the tendon that way. Injections, if you do have a situation where someone got a patella tendon injection, it greatly increases the risk of it rupturing. And then certain medical conditions, renal failure, rheumatoid arthritis, diabetes, lupus, and tends to occur in older men over the age of 40. Sudden, this is something you probably wouldn't see so often in the community clinical setting. More often you'd see in the emergency room, but occasionally someone will come into our office just unable to straighten their leg out. It's called a straight leg raise. If they can do this or they can't do this, their knee just bends, that's a sign that there could be a problem with the quadriceps or the patella tendon. And there's a history of a pop or a tear followed by inability to put weight on it, swelling. You can usually feel the defect. And again, inability to hold the leg straight, and then pain when you try to flex the leg, and always associated with some swelling. If you get x-rays, which we would normally do, you can see the what we call patella alta, where the patella is riding high on the femur, which would suggest that it's not being held down by the patella tendon. MRIs and ultrasound, if there's uncertainty of the diagnosis, you're questioning whether it's a partial tear versus a complete tear, those can help to make the diagnosis. There's a surgical issue, typically urgently, not emergently, but within the outcomes are better the sooner you fix it, and then followed by these days with the ability to create a pretty solid repair, the rehab and the range of motion and strengthening is occurring sooner and with more intensity. So moving on to meniscal tears. There are a variety of meniscal tears. Basically, they can be broken down into stable versus unstable meniscal tears. The stable tears cause pain for a few weeks, not associated with mechanical symptoms, locking, catching, buckling, and symptoms resolve within a week or a few or a month or less. The unstable tears are the big fragments that are moving around like a pebble in your shoe, causing your knee to lock or buckle or catch. When it's clear cut, the unstable tears usually are the ones that need surgery. So these are the different configurations of meniscal tears. This is what we call a bucket handle tear, more common in younger patients, usually traumatic, where like the handle of a bucket, this flap can actually flip into the joint and cause your knee to lock. These are the beak tears or the flap tears, which can be unstable depending on the size. And then you have radial tears here. So these are all sort of in the acute setting, usually traumatic in nature. And then you can have the degenerative tears or the tears associated more with arthritis, then you start to ask whether that it's a stable tear or the pain is associated with the arthritic pain or from the meniscus tear itself. So the traumatic ones can be displaced or non-displaced. The degenerative ones, you often have, those are the patients who come in with an MRI from outside who say, oh, I have a meniscus tear, and you get a weight-bearing view and you see, oh, well, you have arthritis, so the meniscus tear is less of a concern. This is what the tears, this would be a bucket handle tear, what it looks like through the arthroscopy in the OR. This is one of the flap tears. This is a degenerative tear, so it's hidden behind here, but that's more just sort of a complex frayed tear, which can sometimes have mechanical symptoms, but more often associated with arthritis and arthritic pain. So this is what a repair looks like. We can repair certain tears. That they have to be in a certain pattern, meaning very peripheral. The further into the joint they are, the less likely there's a blood supply, so less likely you can repair it. So pretty young age cutoff to do repairs, but we're kind of getting better at the indications for repair. So usually associated with a twisting injury, again, acute swelling. So you can imagine the knee twists causing the meniscus to catch between the bones causing it to tear. And then can be associated with the mechanical symptoms, which would mean an unstable tear. So physical exam, joint line tenderness, and then there's various tests to stress the meniscus. The most common one is what we call McMurray's test, where you're pushing the tibia up against the undersurface of the femur and twisting it to try to pinch that meniscus, and if it's torn, you can feel a pop or a tear movement in the knee and associated with pain. The Apley test is very similar. You're just having the patient lie down and you're pushing the femur down, or the tibia down into the femur when they're prone, but it's the same idea. Weight x-ray is very important because you want to rule out arthritic changes primarily. If you're concerned about an unstable meniscal tear, which again you can usually see on or determine on exam, MRI to confirm it, to rule out other pathology, osteochondral defects, basically for surgical planning. So normal meniscus, dark triangular appearance on the MRI. Abnormal meniscus, there's a white line, which is fluid running through the meniscal tissue, which would indicate a tear. Treatments for the stable tears, rest, physical therapy, usually does the trick. Pain resolves. If it's unstable or becomes unstable, then surgery is necessary. By far, the majority of them are debrided, meaning you take out the torn piece, remove the pebble from the shoe. Especially for the degenerative type tears, so this is obviously not repairable. Repairs are common in younger patients, then the indications are getting better with newer technologies. Used to be a big incision where you'd have to cut open the knee to be able to access the meniscus to do the repair. Now we're using more of these arthroscopic devices, which are little anchors with sutures that can be done through the tiny arthroscopic portals with as good success rates as the open procedures. Moving on to ligament injuries, usually associated with a twisting injury. So remember the collateral ligaments, lateral, medial, and then the ACL, PCL, what we're talking about now. Varus valgus stress can cause injury to the collaterals associated with swelling, intra-articular, versus extra-articular, can determine whether it's a cruciate ligament versus one of the collaterals. Collaterals are associated with more swelling on the side, one side or the other of the knee, no swelling in the knee itself. The cruciate ligament injuries usually produce swelling within the joint. And then the hallmark of an ACL injury is or a grade one, grade three collateral injury is instability. ACL injuries initially cause swelling and pain. After a week or two of swelling control and getting the range of motion back, pain often subsides and they don't have any pain at all. All they have is a sense that their knee's going to give out on them when they move suddenly or switch direction at high speeds. So that's the hallmark for a complete ACL tear. Ligament injuries in general are graded on one, two, or three. So grade one injuries are where the tendon is just stretched a little bit. A grade two is where you've torn some of the fibers, but it's still stable. Grade three is where it's completely torn. And the collateral ligaments tend to heal, even the grade threes, with conservative measures. So bracing, if it's a grade two or three, I'm conservative with bracing. If it's a grade one, I would forego the brace and just let them take it easy and avoid contact sports, that kind of thing. And then getting the range of motion and the muscle balances back as quickly as possible. ACL injuries, again, usually can be determined present to the office acutely after a twisting injury and a pop and swelling and inability to bear weight. Physical therapy, once you make the diagnosis, it's one of the surgeries that is not done acutely. There's a very high risk of stiffness after an ACL injury, and that risk goes way up if you operate on a knee that's already stiff, which inevitably they are with swelling and pain after an initial injury. So the surgery usually occurs 6 to 8 weeks after the injury, and we get them into physical therapy right off the bat to get the swelling under control and get that range of motion back. And my criteria for doing surgery is that they have to have their full range of motion before even considering the surgery. That can be complicated sometimes if there's an associated meniscal tear or something else that's preventing them from getting their full motion back, in which case you have to decide whether you stage a procedure, do a meniscal repair, let them get their full motion back. At that point, come back and do the ACL later. So exam is very accurate with the ACL, and it's a pretty simple exam. It's called the Lockman test. So if you can picture the knee, the cruciate runs from the back of the ACL runs from the back of the femur to the front of the tibia, and by pulling anteriorly on the tibia with the knee bent at 90 degrees, called the anterior drawer test. If you feel a difference between the affected leg and the other leg of up to five or more than 5 millimeters, and it's usually pretty obvious, then that's usually a very highly accurate test to determine that the ACL is torn. The Lockman is the other test you may hear about, which is very similar. It's just instead of the knee bent at 90 degrees, it's bent to about 20 or 30 degrees, which eliminates some of the other stabilizers in the knee and is a more accurate exam actually than the anterior drawer. But if the anterior drawer is positive, you know you're dealing with at least an ACL tear, possibly other ligament injuries. So you're pulling forward on the tibia, and you always have to compare it to the other knee because some people have inherent laxity and you say, oh, that feels really loose. And then you feel the other knee and it's equally loose, then you're probably not dealing with an acute injury. X-rays are helpful, but the diagnosis of an ACL or the confirmation of a diagnosis of an ACL typically involves an MRI. So this is a normal ACL. You can see it clearly running from the tibia to the femur. Abnormal anterior cruciate ligament where it comes up and it's kind of wavy and flopped over and ends right here and is no longer attached to the femur. And that's what a reconstructed ACL looks like, the graft on an MRI post-op. So ACL reconstructions is a constantly evolving surgical technique. We're doing the latest and greatest here at BI Plymouth, where instead of using metal screws and other fixation devices, it's pretty much all bioabsorbable screws, things that don't even show up on X-ray, things that dissolve over time and form bones. So the problems we had with the tunnels widening and grafts loosening has been pretty much eliminated. It also, the better fixation allows for quicker rehab. Patients are getting up and moving much quicker. Within a week, they'll come back to the office, I'll unlock the brace, they'll be moving 0 to 90 degrees within a week, and by 6 weeks, walking around pretty normally. And so even eliminating the screws altogether using transfix pins, which allow for better fixation of soft tissue grafts, which are the more common grafts we're using in younger patients using their hamstring tendons, which have been shown using autograft versus cadaver tendons has better outcomes now. For the first time, we've seen that in younger patient populations, so we're doing more of that. Osteochondral defects, real quick, how are we doing on time?
Good,
yeah. So cartilage damage to the joint, it's different than arthritis in that it's not diffuse wear of the cartilage, but focal defects where a piece of cartilage is either worn out or broken off, producing a loose body, a little piece of cartilage or bone that floats around. And then there's a condition called osteochondritis desiccans in children, which is a less common condition where in a specific part of the lateral femoral condyle, a piece of cartilage can break loose, typically in the same spot in all patients. We don't understand exactly why, but maybe due to the attachment of the PCL pulling on a growth plate, causing the cartilage to loosen and can actually break off and produce a little loose body floating around in the joint. When you go in with a scope, that's what you would see. So history exams, less specific, you're seeing swelling, pain. X-rays can show loose bodies, but quite often can be normal because, again, you're not dealing with an arthritic condition, so the joint space is well maintained. Getting an MRI shows you the cartilage a little bit better. You see the gray line overlying the dark line. That's the articular cartilage lying on top of the subchondral bone. And you can see loose bodies floating around sometimes, which are not radio opaque. If they're strictly cartilage, you won't see them on an X-ray. You need the MRI to see that. So treatments, and again, the MRI showing the not only a defect in the gray line, but a defect in the subchondral bone. That dark line is interrupted as well. So there's a variety of evolving treatments for this. The kind of the go-to first-line treatment is something called a microfracture, which I'll describe. And then there are various different cartilage plugs and other forms of cartilage implants, harvesting cartilage, sending it off to a lab in Cambridge and letting them grow it into millions of cells, which you can then re-implant through different vehicles of scaffolds that you can use as little plugs that fill in the defects. But the microfracture is the easiest. It's something that can be done in one setting. It's not a staged procedure, and it can be done even if you're surprised by finding an osteochondral defect, which was otherwise previously undiagnosed. And the idea is to stimulate new cartilage growth. So in a small lesion which has otherwise normal cartilage around it, you can get scar cartilage to grow back in. And it involves, it can be done arthroscopically using these various tools, which are basically awls that are of a certain diameter that poke little holes. So you find the cartilage defect, clean up the edges of it with a curette so that you have a nice shoulder or dam around the defect. You scrape off the subchondral bone. You use these awls to poke little holes through the subchondral bone, which access the bone marrow, which are stem cells and can differentiate into any type of tissue, and in this case, cartilage. It's not quite normal cartilage. It's what we call scar cartilage. It doesn't look quite the same on in a pathology section, but it's better than a pothole, and it can last for years, if not decades. So after you poke the little holes, you get this mesenchymal blood clot, which are the bone marrow cells that seep up through these holes and fill in the defect, and over time, over the course of about 6 to 8 weeks, they differentiate into new cartilage. So this is what the MRI looks like before microfracture, this obvious defect, intact subchondral bone, which is important, but that gray line is interrupted. Same patient a month or two later, 3 months later. Again, you can tell it's not quite the same as the surrounding healthy hyaline cartilage, but there's something there, and it's better than it was. And looking at it through the arthroscopy camera months later, you can hardly differentiate it. It looks like normal cartilage. All of these conditions can lead then to arthritis, which again wasn't going to be the focus of this talk, but can be range from mild, moderate to severe, mild disease, and then we're dealing with conservatively severe arthritis, bone on bone, leading to the knee replacements. And we're doing more and more of these partial knee replacements for this middle group, which we didn't have a good answer for prior. So the single or bicompartmental medial lateral makoplasties we're doing more and more of, especially in that middle age group with limited pain. So summary of non-operative treatment. Most of what we do is an initial presentation, especially for these tendonitis and patellofemoral syndromes and stable meniscal tears. Physical therapy is key. Anti-inflammatories, we prescribe boatloads of this stuff every week. And then moving on to injections, which are usually second line of defense if you're not responding to the conservative measures as we would expect, or if pain is so severe that you're not going to be able to do the physical therapy, can be useful. So when to order x-rays, tests, x-rays we tend to do on, I do on most comers, anyone with knee pain, weight bearing, and, or if you suspect a fracture. For most cases, elective outpatient visits, we do the weight bearing views because you want to be able to see that joint space, and you can be misled by normal x-rays that you get in the emergency room, which rule out fracture, but don't really tell you much about the joint space or patella alignment, that sort of thing. So we almost always get the weight-bearing views in the office. And you can see whether, when in the weight-bearing view, normal joint space is here, loss of joint space medially on the contralateral knee, which you wouldn't necessarily see if they were lying down for the x-ray. MRIs. We use pretty conservatively. Acute injuries with mechanical symptoms. If you suspect an ACL and you're planning surgery, or if you're trying to determine the grade of another suspected ligament injury, and failure to improve with conservative measures if you're looking for an osteochondral defect or some other underlying condition as preventing patellofemoral pain or other non-operative treatments from getting better. When to refer. Any acute injury where the patient has a lot of swelling and is unable to bear weight, patient has mechanical symptoms, locking, catching, the knee giving out when they're walking around, or if they failed conservative measures, which we usually define as 6 weeks of physical therapy and anti-inflammatories and rest. So that's the summary.